Well, hey, Harvest, we are so glad that you decided to join us today. And we are extremely psyched to be here because we're back.
They gave us
a chance, you know? And so we're pumped to host the Harvest Bible Chapel pregame show. So let's do it. My name is Zach Moore. This is my lovely bride, Rachel. And I work on staff at the cathedral as the music director. And I also have the privilege of playing drums for Vertical Worship. And I'm telling you, it's just like, it's my dream job. It's amazing. And Rachel is a project manager for a creative design company and also leads worship on the weekends. And we just love life together. I'm telling you right now. We started attending Harvest back in 2018, and we just love it. It's amazing. And so I think that's enough about us, though. So, Rachel, why don't you tell us a little bit about Harvest Kids?
Yeah, well, first off, it's October already.
Wow, it's crazy.
Blows my mind. It's my favorite time of year. But yes. We've been online since mid-March, which is crazy. And that includes Harvest Kids. So, parents, we want to remind you about all the awesome resources we have for your kids at home. We know that many of them are having to do school online right now. Many people are working from home.
That's right.
People are attending church still from home. Yep. So we want to remind you, Harvest Kids staff puts out awesome resources that are new every single week, and you can find those at harvestnow.info.
That's right. I love it, Rach. So Harvest Kids is incredible. Something else that's incredible is our Harvest Student Ministry. And we are continuing to offer a weekly live stream service for our students every Wednesday, and it is absolutely incredible, and our student team is doing a great job of making that happen. And although the live stream is great, I've heard that we're going to start joining in person soon, which
is really exciting.
And so we're looking forward to that. So parents, go to harvestnow.info to find all those details and information. Harvestnow.info.
You can find pretty much anything you need to
know. Any question you have on planet Earth, go to harvestnow.info.
That's what it seems. Well, anyway, well, enough of the pregame.
Yeah, I think
that's it. Let's get down to why we're actually here. So wherever you are, we invite you to stand, lift your hands, and let's worship the Lord together.
I love it.
Well, hey, everyone. We just want to invite you, wherever you are today, would you worship with us? Our God is worthy. He is unchanging. And we're going to lift our hearts in worship to our God, King Jesus. Contained.
Amazing grace that far outweighs my past mistakes. Your death became the death of shame. I'll praise you for amazing grace. Sing that again. Amazing grace. Amazing grace. Amazing grace that far outweighs my past mistakes. Your death became the death of shame. I'll praise you for amazing grace. Oh, praise, oh, praise. See, the old life has come and the new has begun. Your name always. Jesus, you alone deserve. We have a baptism testimony that we get to see right now, celebrate God and what He is doing. Check this out.
Well, hey, Harvest, it's baptism weekend, and all around our campuses there are baptisms, and we are up here at Camp Harvest at the men's retreat, and we have a baptism today. Young Matthew Romek from our Aurora campus is excited and desiring to be baptized, and we thought what better place to do it than right here in the pond. Well, as you can see, the pond is steaming because it's 32 degrees out here. And we had a frost warning last night, but of course, the water is probably going to be a little bit warmer. So we're going to get right to it here with young Matthew. Matthew, why don't you tell us when it is that you first received Jesus Christ?
I first accepted Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, in eighth grade when I was doing my devotions. And I prayed to Him, asking Him to come into my heart and to change my life, saying, I want to give my life to Him and live for Him.
Well, that's amazing. That's amazing. And how's your life been different since then?
I've got a huge desire to share the gospel to my friends, my neighbors, and like on the internet too. And He's just been working in me a lot, helping me like follow Him more, a desire to read the Bible.
Yeah, we were sharing that you make videos and you're sharing it with your friends and everyone. So what an encouragement to young people out there to just not be ashamed of the gospel and to share it with everyone. Yeah. So. That's amazing. Well, why don't you tell everyone why you want to be baptized today, and even if you'd like to add, why Camp Harvest?
Yeah, I want to be baptized to obey Jesus and to show that I'm not ashamed of the gospel. And I chose Camp Harvest because it's one of my favorite places to be.
That's amazing. And you've been coming to Camp Harvest since, you know, you were a kid too, so this is a special place. Well, we're going to get in the water now, and we're going to do this. All right, Matthew. Your dad, Greg, is here. This is great. Because of your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
From the grave, from the grave, into the dark, You called my name and brought me back to life again. I rose with you up from the grave.
Sing it again.
Up from the grave, up from the grave, into the dark, you called my name. From the grave, all praise, soon. Your promises, oh, they all come true. God, we will fix our eyes on you, 'cause we believe you're coming soon. Yes, we will fix our eyes on you. Your promises, they all come true. And all praise, to see the old life is gone and a new has begun. Jesus, you alone deserve all praise. And all praise, you see the old life is gone, and the new has begun. Your name, yes, your name always. And Jesus, you alone deserve all praise, yes, Jesus, you alone deserve all praise. Yes, you do. Sing that. Jesus, you alone deserve all praise. Yes, Jesus, you alone deserve all praise. One more time. Jesus, you alone deserve all praise. Amen.
Well, hey, Harvest, we're so glad that you've decided to join us again today. If you missed the beginning of the service, my name's Zach, and this is Rachel, and we're just so excited that you decided to join us today.
Yeah, and especially if this is your first time joining us, we want to welcome you. We're so excited that you're joining us, and Give us a shout out, or give your city a shout out.
Give us a shout out. We don't need one.
Give your city a shout out. We want to know where you're watching from. You can do that in the chat, in the comments. And it's just so cool to see like where Harvest Online is.
Yeah,
you know,
it's
everywhere, and it's awesome. Well, whether you're new or you watch every single week, this is the time we want you to check in. You can check in through the link in the comments below, or you can check in through the mobile app. And just the reason we want you to do that is because we want to know that you are here, and we want to know how we can be praying for you this week. This next announcement,
it's exciting.
I'm pumped for all six of our campuses. We're back, we're meeting in person, and I can say like the past few weeks have just been so awesome.
They've been incredible, absolutely.
To be together again and just hear people singing again, and God is just so faithful, and we just thank him that we're able to meet together.
That's right.
But we do know that not everyone is able to meet together at this time, so we want to remind you that we'll continue our online services on Sunday morning at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. And even if you can't make those times, you or someone you know, the services will be on demand. You can find those at harvestbiblechapel.org and on our Harvest Bible Chapel YouTube channel. So you can check those out later if you need to.
That's right. Hey, and it's been a little bit of a difficult year, as we all know, but I just wanted to thank you for being a faithful giver to Harvest Bible Chapel. And I love it because that is obedience to the Lord. And I mean, that's what we're called to do. And so thank you for your tithes and offerings. And we want to just remind you of the different ways that you can do that. So online, obviously at harvestbiblechapel.org, through the mobile app, you can text as well. And if you want to, you can send checks in the mail to Harvest Bible Chapel, the Rolling Meadows campus. Something that's been really, really exciting this week, actually currently right now, is the men's retreat up at Camp Harvest.
It
looked a little chilly in the video, but I mean, it looks like just some great things are going on. And they've been able to work together and probably play different games and study God's word. And how awesome was it to see that baptism?
Oh, man. That was so awesome.
I know, right? And even though it was a little bit chilly, it looked like it's just amazing to see how God is just working in people's lives.
Yeah.
And it's just so great to be a part of that here at Harvest. And so, well, we're going to continue in worship. But before we do that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, we are so thankful to be able to gather and, Lord, to be able to talk to you freely through prayer. Lord, we're thankful for Harvest and its ministry, Lord, and how you're still working through it. God, I am just so thankful for the series that we're in, and we're just asking that you would indeed teach us to pray, God. We love you so much, Lord. We truly do. And we pray that you would open the eyes of our heart right now as we continue in worship. In your name I pray, Lord, amen. So we're going to ask you again to stand and raise your voice as we continue in worship.
We praise you. We magnify you today. God, we choose to say that above everything, that over everything, we are acknowledging the fact that you, Lord, are King who reigns over all. Whether there's a situation in our life that feels out of control, you're in control. When it feels like we see chaos, you're still in control. And so, God, we magnify you. And in the same way that we look to our Lord who reigns over all, we look to you now, God, and we open our hearts and we ask, God, would you speak to me? God, as we open your word, we open our hearts and we say, Lord, would you make us more like you? Would you let me be changed? We love you, Lord. And it's in the holy and perfect and matchless name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Amen.
Well, Harvest, it is so good to be with you as we continue in our series, Teach Us to Pray. And we are walking through the Lord's Prayer together in Matthew 6. And today we're going to be in verse 10, the later part of verse 10. But really quickly, before we jump into the text, I want to talk about collisions. I want to talk about collisions. You know, 10 years ago, before I came to Harvest, I bought a new car. And I loved the new car. It was awesome. I had the 6-year payment plan, you know, because reasons. It was a Ford Focus. It was silver. Don't judge me. Okay, don't judge. And I was ready to drive this car until the wheels fell off of it. I absolutely loved it. It was a manual, so it was pretty awesome. And fast forward 6 years, I just paid it off. It's a big accomplishment in a young man's life, paying off a car. And I still loved the car. It was running great. Again, still, I wanted to drive it until it literally fell apart. And so a couple of weeks after I had just paid it off, I was actually doing a funeral in for a distant relative of mine. And it was at a bar, which is a weird venue for a funeral, but that's a story for another time. I'm on my way home from that funeral. I'm driving through Arlington Heights. It had just rained, and I'm following behind this car, and we're coming up to a stoplight, and the stoplight is green. And I'm not really paying that much attention. I'm still focused on the road because I'm being a good driver. And in front of me, the car slams into the back of another car. Just no warning, no nothing. Just completely comes to a dead stop because it slammed into another car. And so I have nanoseconds to react. And so I hit the brakes, but like I said, it was raining. And so I slid in, and I'm like, as I'm going in, I'm like, do I straighten my arms? What do I do? I don't know. I'd never been in a car accident before, and so the only noise that came out of my mouth was like, you know, something like that. And so I slammed into the back of the car, and I watched as my newly paid-off car, the front of it, folded up like an accordion. It was devastating. And that was my first and thankfully only serious car accident. But listen, it changed the way that I drive. It changed the way that I think about driving. Now I'm very aware. I'm very attentive. I am very defensive, especially when it comes to stoplights and cars in front of me. I'm given about 17 car lengths in between me and the car in front of me. I've got my foot off of the gas and just gingerly touching the brake, ready to press it at any moment. I'm looking left and right, looking for escape paths, just in case that were to ever happen again. It changed the way that I drive because I don't ever want to be in that situation again. It was dangerous, it was scary, it was life-threatening, and it totaled my car. So my behavior and my thoughts and my actions in my driving changed that day. You see, collisions tend to wake you up. They tend to shape your behavior and your thoughts and your actions going forward. If I keep doing this, I'm putting my life in danger. If I keep doing this way, I'm putting myself at risk. So that brings us to the title of the message today, which is The Great Collides. The Great Collides. There's a couple of them. Listen, we need some collisions to wake us up, to shape our behavior and actions and thoughts concerning our spiritual life, our prayer life. We need these collisions. And we're going to see three of them today in the text that we need to happen in our spiritual life, in our prayer life. I'm going to give them to you right now, and then we're going to go through them. The first collision is the collision of wills, a collision of wills. Collision number two is a collision of location, a collision of locations. And the third collision is a collision of persons, a collision of persons. Like I said, we're in Matthew chapter 6 at the end of verse 10. Let's read it together. Here's our text today. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Here's the first collision right here for us, the collision of wills. It is his will over my will. His will over my will. Listen, just go ahead and right now, underline in your Bible, your will be done, right? your will. Underline your will, because whose will needs to be done here? God's will needs to be done. Not my will, his will. And this is the first collision. Too many of us are praying and saying, my will be done. Our will be done. And not God's will to be done. Why? Well, because we don't like that. We don't like that at all. We want to do what we want. We want to do our own will. We want to do the things that we want to do. We want our own desires. I want my own desires. I want my own plan to happen. I want my own path to travel. I want my own will to be done. And maybe sometimes it's not so on the nose. Maybe it's a little bit more subtle. Maybe it's, Lord, your will be done, as long as it's not too far away from where I want to go. Or maybe it's, Lord, your will be done, as long as I still get what I want in the end. Or maybe it's, Lord, your will be done, as long as I can get to my path at some point eventually. Again, this isn't his will over mind. That's like sort of his will, but kind of mine still, which, newsflash, isn't actually his will. His will, get this, is his will. It's not ours. It is 100% God's will and 0% my will. And this isn't some weird power play by God, although if it were, it would be fine because, you know, he's God. But it's because when we're left to our own will, we go towards destruction. We mess up, we destroy, we ruin, we sin. That's what we do when we go after our own will. And God is saying, my will, because it will bring me glory, but also because it is for your good. And so Jesus is teaching us to pray. He's teaching us the better way. He is teaching us to pray, not my will be done, but God, your will be done. And listen, he isn't only teaching us that here. He lives this out perfectly in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus is not a hypocrite. He doesn't say, do what I say, not what I do. He talks the talk and walks the walk. He lives this out perfectly. The night before he will be killed in the Garden of Gethsemane, he prays to the Father and he says, my Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Jesus demonstrates this prayer for us in the midst of massive distress. He is sweating blood. He is faced with death. And yet he says, God, your will, not mine. Wow. Jesus is teaching us to pray this because prayer transforms our hearts and it aligns our will with God's will. God's will over my will. That's what Jesus is teaching us here. Not our will, but his will. And that needs to be our prayer. So that's great, right? We see that. But maybe you ask a question that I sometimes ask is, well, okay, so I want that. God, your will be done. But how do I know? What is God's will? What am I asking for? What am I praying for when I'm saying, God, your will be done? What is God's will? And let me just say, the great thing is that we can know God's will. First, know that the scriptures reveal two wills. I made a little graphic for us so that will be easier for us to follow along. There's two wills of God. There is God's sovereign will and there is God's commanded will. God's sovereign will and God's commanded will, and they are different. God's sovereign will is secret. It is a mystery. It is known only as revealed through history or revelation. So whatever has come through history we've seen, we know that that is God's sovereign will, and whatever he has revealed, maybe through prophecy, or maybe even he has shared through and led us through with the Holy Spirit, it's only known as revealed through history or revelation. Whereas God's commanded will is revealed in the Bible. It's revealed in the scriptures for us. We can see that. We have God's commanded will for us to see. God's sovereign will cannot be resisted or thwarted. It cannot be resisted or thwarted. When God said, let there be light, there was light. When God said, the universe is being created, the universe was created, and all things are now being held together by his will, by his sovereign will. It cannot be resisted and it cannot be thwarted. God's commanded will can be resisted, or what we more likely say is it can be disobeyed. God's sovereign will encompasses both good and evil. Now, we could stop here and unpack that a little bit. Maybe that sounds a little confusing to you, that God's will would encompass both good and evil. But let me just give you a specific example of that to help us. So a great, perfect example of that is the road of Jesus to the cross. Jesus going to the cross and dying for our sins was God's sovereign will. But inside of that, there needed to be some evil that happened. Judas needed to betray Jesus. Pilate needed to wash his hands. The Jewish leaders needed to unjustly persecute and arrest Jesus. And the Romans needed to unjustly kill Jesus on the cross. There was evil there. But God used all of that for the greatest thing in human history, the redemption of mankind. So God's sovereign will encompasses both good and evil. God's commanded will involves only that which is good and holy. God's commanded will is sanctification. It is holiness for us. God's sovereign will is comprehensive. It controls all aspects of life and time and history, whereas God's commanded will is specific. It provides principles for us to live, principles for our daily Christian living. God's sovereign will, the believer is not commanded to know or discover what God has not revealed. We're not commanded to know or discover that. Now, God can lead us and prompt us through his Holy Spirit or through prayer, absolutely, but we are not commanded to know or discover what God has not yet revealed. Whereas God's commanded will, we are exhorted to know and understand and obey all that God has revealed. So what will is being talked about here in the passage? Which one? Well, it's both. It's both. It says, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And which will is happening in heaven? Both of them. His sovereign will is happening in heaven, and his commanded will is happening in heaven as well. So it's both of these. And so when we pray this, we are aligning ourselves with God's will, which is for our good. It's for our sanctification. It is for our holiness. It is for our benefit to the glory of God. And when we're not aligning with God's will, but instead we are saying and praying, my will be done, this is what happens. Made a short little video for you. Yeah, right? Come on. Someone say amen, right? That is what happens when we throw our will and we say, my will, I mean, it is a mess. It leads to destruction, to brokenness, to imbalance, which is what's happening with that washing machine, with that brick. When we align to our own will, it throws our life out of balance and it starts to break. We run after our fleshly passions. We break relationships. We fall into dark sin. We lose purpose. We get shaken by everything that comes our way. We second guess everything when we operate in our own will. Every situation shakes us because we are never truly sure it's the right choice. But when we are aligned with God's will over my will, we can be certain of the path forward. We can be certain of the path forward. When I am aligned with God's will over my will, nothing can shake me. When I am aligned with God's will over my will, nothing can shake me. The story of Daniel 3, which is many of you probably know this, is the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Rakshak and Benny, right? And many of you know this, but if you don't know this, Rakshak and Benny, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they love the Lord. They worship God, and they know God's commanded will for their life is to worship only the one true God. They know that. And they are aligned with that. But this king, he builds a golden image and tells people when the music plays, the people of the kingdom need to bow down and they need to worship this golden image. And Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're aligned with God's will and they're like, we're not going to do that. And the king says that anyone who doesn't is going to be put in a fiery furnace. And that's where we pick up in Daniel 3:16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And he will deliver us out of your hand, O King. Here it is, unshakable. But if not, it gives me chills every time I read it. Be it known to you, O King, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up. This is what lives aligned with God's will over my will looks like. Unshakable. No matter the circumstance, no matter the situation, no matter the consequence, even death, the worst earthly consequence we could face, even in that, when aligned with God's will over my will, you will not be shaken. Now, that is a pretty extreme example, life and death. What about everyday life? Not everything is life and death. Well, I have a really practical example for us. Really practical, and I think that we could all probably grab a hold of this given our current climate, and that is politics. Oh, Pastor, don't bring politics into this church service. Listen, first off, some of you are already shaken by me just saying the word politics, and let me just tell you, I can't help it, all right? Y'all brought politics onto my Facebook feed, so here we are. Listen, I either have to get off of Facebook or I have to address this here, okay? And I know that some of you, you think that your presidential candidate, whichever one it is, the one that you're going for, is God's will for our country. And can I just say, we can talk about the validity of that argument maybe after the service, but I want to hyper-focus in on something here. And that is the way in which Christian brothers and sisters have been speaking to each other and to those who are not Christians. You've seen it. I've seen it. Goodness. Can I just say, with absolute certainty, we can know that that is not the commanded will of God for our lives. That is not the commanded will of God for our lives. He commands you to love one another. Even if you consider them your mortal enemy, love is the commandment. Even if you think that they're evil, we don't repay evil with evil. We repay evil with good. That is God's commanded will for us. And listen, maybe you're hearing me right now, and maybe I've triggered you a little bit. Can I just say, I'm not sorry, okay? You need to stop spewing hate to each other. That is not God's will. Being passionate about politics is not bad. Maybe you're passionate, and that's not bad. But interacting with each other with vileness and vitriol and hatred for the other side, that is bad. And listen to me, maybe before you hop onto Facebook and you see something that you don't like, or you read an article you don't like, and you are ready. You're ready. Maybe before you get political, you need to get prayerful. Maybe before you get political, you need to get prayerful. God, your will be done. God, your will be done. Not my will, because my will right now wants to light this person up for what they believe and who they're following. Your will be done, because your will and your word commands me to love, to speak truth, yes, but in love and with grace, and not my truth, but your truth. And maybe this has been a stumbling block for you. Every time politics is brought up, it shakes you. It shakes you. Maybe God's will, it makes you nervous. You get afraid, and this shakes you. You're fearful. Or maybe it literally shakes you because you're so angry at the conversation that is happening. Can I just say something? Maybe God's will is that the other presidential candidate than who you want is going to be the next president. And you may think that that's awful, and you may think that they're terrible, and you may think that they're evil. And why would God do that? Listen, history shows us that God did that pretty often with Israel. God used bad kings and good kings to bring his people back to himself. And maybe God is going to do something in our nation for our good or for our judgment to bring us back to himself. Maybe he is trying to teach us something. His will be done, not ours. And when we align with that, we become unshakable. God, have your way. I will follow wherever it is, whatever it is. I am aligning with your will. And so I think that that naturally has a question for us. How do I know that I'm aligning with God's will? It's simply this. You know you're aligning with God's will if you are living according to God's word. How do you know you're aligning with God's will? You're living according to God's word. And some, I come across people like all the time. They're like, that can't be it. That can't be it. God's will is much more mysterious than that. There needs to be something deeper. That seems too easy. And first off, that's not easy, okay? Sure, it is simple, living according to God's word. It's simple to understand that. It is not easy. You have to die to your will every single day. You have to die to self every day to live according to his word, aligning yourself with his will. It is not easy. It is one of the hardest things that you will ever do. It is simple, but it is not easy. So how do I know I'm aligned with God's will? It's if I'm living according to God's word. So am I aligned with God's will? Am I living according to his word? Are you praying, God, your will be done, not my own? His will over my will. That's the first collision. That's the first collision. On to collision number two. Collision of locations. Heaven over earth. Continue in the verse. On earth as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. What a prayer that is. On earth as it is in heaven. This is prayer that the things happening in heaven will be reflected on earth. So naturally, we have to ask the question, well, what is happening in heaven? And I think we probably get the clearest view of what's happening in heaven by looking at the angels. What are they doing in heaven? So here's a bit of angelology. That's a real word. It's a theological term for the study of angels. In heaven, angels do the will of God. In heaven, angels do the will of God perfectly. Angels worship God continually. Angels celebrate at the salvation of sinners. When there is a sinner who comes to repentance, there is a party in heaven with the angels. Angels celebrate God forever with redeemed humanity. Those who have gone before us are celebrating with the angels God forever. Angels delight in and are in wonder at the gospel. They delight in the gospel going forth and they wonder in it. What else is taking place in heaven? Well, because God's will is being done perfectly in heaven, there's perfect peace, there's perfect joy, there's perfect justice, there's perfect comfort, there is perfect encouragement, there is perfect love, and so on. And when we pray this prayer of on earth as it is in heaven, we are saying, God, bring these things to this broken world, which really is the story of the Bible. The redemption of his creation by what Jesus did on the cross, his death, burial, and resurrection, redeeming mankind to the glory of God. It's like this. Maybe you need a little bit of a visual. I'm a visual learner too. And so when we pray this prayer on heaven, on earth as it is in heaven, think of it like there are two spaces, two circles, and they overlap. There's a collision that's taken place. And on here we have the space of heaven. Sorry, my handwriting is terrible. And this is God's kingdom. And over here we have earth. And it's full of sin and dark. We have two spaces. And you can see right here they overlap. They've collided. And this space in the Old Testament was the tabernacle, or the temple that was built, where God would come and dwell. He would literally unite heaven and earth with his presence. And then in the New Testament, we have Jesus Christ. And Jesus on the cross united heaven and earth. He's literally the tabernacle of God in human form, coming to earth. And when we pray on earth as it is in heaven, we are praying, Lord, help me to take the gospel of Jesus Christ out into this broken and dark and sinful world. On earth as it is in heaven. And we are purposed to bring that because of what Jesus has done on the cross. We can take the light of the gospel to a dark world. I'll be totally transparent with you. I don't pray this enough. I don't pray like this enough. God, on earth as it is in heaven, help me, Lord, to align with your will and bring your gospel to this world. May it be on earth as it is in heaven. And use me, Lord, to fulfill your purposes. We are heaven bringers to this dark world. Let's pray like that. Jesus teaches us that. And maybe one of the things that gets in the way is when we want to pray on earth as it is in heaven, maybe some of you get overwhelmed. I know that I do. And something that really helped me is being specific. You know, earth is a really big place. It's big. It's round, right? It's big. And so praying more specifically, maybe not on earth as it is in heaven. Prayer that I've often said over the past couple of months is in Elgin as it is in heaven. In Rolling Meadows as it is in heaven. In Aurora as it is in heaven. In Crystal Lake as it is in heaven. In Deerfield Road as it is in heaven. In Chicago as it is in heaven. You could even get more specific. More specific. In my home as it is in heaven. In my family as it is in heaven. In my workplace as it is in heaven. In my neighborhood as it is in heaven. In my church as it is in heaven. In me as it is in heaven. Let my mind and my heart be focused on that. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Write this down. Remind yourself to pray like this. Write this down on the mirrors of your house. This home as it is in heaven. Write this down on a sticky note and stick it to your computer at the office. In this office as it is in heaven. Put it on a note card and place it in your car. In this car as it is in heaven. On this road as it is in heaven. In this town I'm driving through as it is in heaven. Remind yourself to pray like this. God has given us the opportunity to bring heaven through the gospel of Jesus Christ to a broken world. Let's pray like this. Here's the third and final collision. It's a collision of persons. Now you may be thinking, the astute among you, you're like, well, we're done. Like it was, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's the end of the verse. Listen, we're not in a verse right now because I want to show you something that we've been going through in the Lord's Prayer. This week is actually a pivot point in the Lord's Prayer. It starts with the exaltation and the glory of God. And then starting next week in verse 11 and ongoing, it goes into the needs of us, the needs of mankind. I'm not going to spoil anything that's coming up in the next weeks, but I want to note the structure of how Jesus is teaching us to pray. Here's the structure. God over me. God over me. That is the structure that Jesus is teaching us how to pray. It begins with God. He is first. We talked about when we pray, our hearts are transformed and our wills are aligned with God's will. But another aspect of prayer is worship. And so in prayer, we are humbly submitting to God and we are worshiping Him for who He is. He is worthy of our praise. He is worthy of our thanks. He is worthy of our adoration. And so Jesus is teaching us here. He's teaching us a structure. God first, and then my needs. Then we could get there. Listen, my needs are important to God. God cares about my needs, but God is first. And Jesus knows this. And Jesus knows us perfectly. And He knows that if we were to be focused on leaving God out of our prayer, excluding Him from exaltation, excluding Him from thanksgiving, that we would focus on ourselves. We would focus on us. And when can we get to my needs? I'm putting myself first. I'm the most important. God, I'm talking to you so that I can fulfill my needs and wants and my desires. Our prayers become quarters. prayers become quarters. And we treat God like a vending machine. We say a prayer, we put it in the slot, and we press A4. Yes, what I want. May that not be so of us. God is not a cosmic vending machine. And we don't use prayer as a vehicle to receive what we want. We use prayer to worship God, to talk to God, to have relationship with God, to transform our hearts, to align us with his will. John 3:30 should be the battle cry in our prayers. He must increase and I must decrease. We come to the Father in reverence and humility and worship first and foremost. Then we petition or ask for our needs to be met. Because again, that's important to God. He cares about our needs. Our needs matter to him. But we need to keep first things first. We need to recognize God as Father, our Father in heaven. We need to recognize God whose name is reverent. Hallowed be your name. We need to recognize God as King. Your kingdom come. He is the King of that kingdom. We need to recognize God as Master. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In your prayer time this week, use the structure that Jesus gives, that he has given to us here in the Lord's Prayer. God over me. His will over my will. Heaven over earth. God over me. These truths, when they collide with us, will transform our prayer lives, church. So let's have the collision and let our prayer lives be changed by it. Let's pray. God, you are a good Father. Lord, we worship you. We praise you. Thank you so much for your word that you have given to us, your commanded will that you have given to us. Lord, we recognize you now as King. We recognize you as Master. Lord, thank you for your word today and the truths that you have for us so that we can align with your will. Lord, help us. That is such a difficult thing to do. We are so wont to go astray. Lord, help us to pray like this. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God, we need you. We need your help. We give this all to you. You who are faithful, you who can do exceedingly and abundantly more than we can think, ask, or even imagine. We love you, Lord. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Words of Christ passed down through generations, the Son of God teaching us to pray, echoed words, Father, have your will, your way in me completely. We wholly trust faithful in provision, amazing grace, mercy for our sins. May we forgive the way that you've forgiven us, oh Lord, so we can sing. Your will.
Lord, can teach us, continue to teach us to pray. We love you. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us at church this weekend or during the week. Whenever you're watching this, please know you are loved.